good morning. Welcome again. This is an exciting time for us. We've waited a long time to get here, and I'm so pleased that you all have chosen to attend with us. The first thing I'd like to do is ask you to stand, and we will do a salute to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. I'd like to thank our color guard this afternoon, or this morning actually, for pulling this together. It means a great deal to us. Thank you very, very much. I have a lot of cheat sheets. So today is 9/11. It's a very significant day for all of us. It's something we'll always remember. It's also Patriots Day today. So again, a very fitting date for our groundbreaking. At this particular time, I'd like to pause for a moment of silence. And in that moment of silence, please remember Mr. Sisson, Mr. O'Connor, and all of our fallen heroes that we've lost along the way. Thank you, because without Mr. Sisson and Mr. O'Connor, we wouldn't be here today. We have a very short program. We have some speakers, and I will get through that as quickly as possible. First of all, I'd like to introduce the invited guests. Some of them are here. Some of them may have sent a representative. If I've missed you, just raise your hand, let me know you're here. First of all, is Ian Tremblay here from Congressman? Ian, thank you so much. From Congressman William Keating's office, thank you. The governor was invited. He was not able to attend. Invited also was Representative Chris Markey and Senator Mark Montigny. Town Administrator, Mr. Cressman, are you here? Mr. Cressman is here, as well as Deborah. Mrs. O'Connor is here. Thank you, Mrs. O'Connor. And Mrs. Sisson, thank you. We have members of our designer selection committee. These three men helped get together to choose our architect. My designer selection committee was Richard Esquino. Richard, thank you. Rob Gomes and Michael Walker. Thank you so much for a job well done. We also had invited former representative John Quinn, but I don't see him. The former representative was very, very instrumental in helping us get this going. He petitioned the legislature, and without him, he was really our moving force, and I thank him. I wish he was here. Representatives from the Dartmouth Council on the Aging, Debbie Raymond, the former executive director, and the new one, Heather Sylvia. Welcome, thank you. We'll be working closely together. Dartmouth Friends of the Elderly, Ron Souza, is not here, and Maria Connor, president. James Collins from, there we go, thank you so much. Stevens and Company, I'm not quite sure if they sent anybody over, but Stevens and Company, we thank you for your hospitality and your support. Where am I? Mr. and Mrs. Gerald Wheeler. Mr. Wheeler is here. He is our next door neighbor. Again, awesome support, and we thank you so much. Roy Oliveira, our veterans agent from Dartmouth, was also invited, as well as Chris Gomes from the New Bedford Veterans Agency, but I don't believe he came. We have other distinguished guests in the audience, and they will be announced during the presentation. At this time, I'd like to introduce our project team. We have two really, really good boards. I am so blessed because I have two boards that are awesome, and without them, we wouldn't be doing this. Partners in Housing, I have Michael Gagne, President, Maria Connor, Secretary, Matt O'Connor, our Treasurer, Mr. Seeger, who could not make it this morning, and Kevin Shea. My Dartmouth Housing Authority Board, my anchor here, Elaine Lancaster is our Chair, Wayne Wally is our Vice Chair, Maria Connor is our Treasurer, and Sam Johnson. Again, I thank my board, both boards, they're awesome people. Our architect, and he's not here, JMB. Okay, maybe he'll pop in later. But JMB from New Bedford, they're our architects. Our contractor, Collins Construction, and we have Mr. Collins here. There he is. Thank you. My friends from Women's Institute. Gabby. I'm not going to sit anymore. She and I are like this. I'm telling you. Us service partners, we have two service providers that have openly decided to work with us to give these veterans the services that they are both going to need and deserve. And I'd like to recognize Jim Reed from the Veterans Transition House, Jim, and Paula Shiner. Paula, good morning, from Coastline Elderly Services. These two services are going to be paramount to this house, and without them, we wouldn't be able to do it, so thank you so much. And we have legal services, Klein Hornig, I don't believe they're here, and Perry Hicks, DeShays, and Mello, and I don't believe they're here either. But all of these people have been so, so instrumental in pulling all of this together, and I say thank you. So then we needed a lot of funding for this program. And it was a long road. There's a lot of work, a lot of people pulling together, lots and lots and lots of hours. But we got it. And I'm just going to give you a little segue. We didn't make it the first two rounds. But then we were invited to put in a speedy application. And the Friday before Christmas, I'm driving back to work from a meeting, and I got a phone call and said, Merry Christmas, you've been fully funded. Best day of my life. That was so exciting. So again, we thank all those people who pulled together for many, many hours. The town of Dartmouth CPC, they provided us with so much support and three rounds of funding. And Buddy Baker-Smith could not make it this morning, but our thanks go out to the CPC and all of the town members who voted to allot us the money that we needed to get this project off the ground. The Commonwealth of Massachusetts, through the Department of Housing and Community Development, and the Secretary of the Commonwealth's office, who provided $675,000 of funds through the Housing Preservation Stabilization Trust Fund, along with the 9 MRVP vouchers that will be used to house our veterans, and the social services subsidy of $2,500 a unit. Without that subsidy, we would not be able to provide the services we're going to provide. I'd like to thank Kate Racer, and I would like to invite Ayanna Gonzalez to come up and say a few words. Ayanna?
Hi. Thanks, Connie. So I'm going to be brief, but on behalf of the Baker-Polito administration, I'd just like to congratulate the Dartmouth Housing Authority and its partners for all the work that they've done here, getting you from an idea to an actual groundbreaking. As you all know, Governor Baker is really, really committed to ending homelessness among veterans. And these 9 units here, supportive housing for veterans that are homeless or at risk of homelessness, will really play a critical role in the Commonwealth's work towards that goal. As you said, that the state has supported this project with HIF, HIPSTIF, and MRVP. And we're just really, really thrilled and excited to be able to utilize these resources here at this project. I know the town of Dartmouth that the Housing Authority in Dartmouth hasn't done a project like this in a while. And I just think that, you know, this is, congratulations, it's really, really worth the work and the wait. So thank you so much for having me, and congratulations.
Thank you, Ayanna. And I have to say, some of these people I have met for the first time today, but we have been talking on the phone for months and months and months, so it's really nice to put names and faces together after all this time. Thank you. We have also received funding from the Federal Home Loan Bank of Boston and their member bank of Bay Coast Bank. They provided an affordable housing program direct subsidy. I believe we have some people in the audience from there. Christine Rogers, Carl Tabor, if you're here, just raise your hand so we can recognize you. Ann Auger, hi Ann, and Ken Willis. And I believe Ken is going to address us. Ken, thank you.
I know, I thought you were next. Well, good morning, everyone. My name's Ken Willis. I'm First Vice President at the Federal Home Loan Bank of Boston. It's always a pleasure to be a part of these celebrations. Just to give you a little bit of a background, a lot of folk don't know about the Federal Home Loan Bank, but we are a wholesale bank. That means we provide liquidity for other banks, credit unions, insurance companies, and community development financial institutions. So all of the money that we provide for projects like this actually flow through one of those institutions. So you mentioned Bay Coast Bank. That's how our grant got to the bank, to this project. In addition, this project is really an example of how small projects can really make a big deal. We fund a lot of different sizes of projects at the bank, but these 9 units for veterans will be critical, and our subsidy is going to play a big part of that. I did want to make mention, as part of the bank's mission, we have an affordable housing program where the bank allocates 10% of its earnings to this specialized competitive program called the Affordable Housing Program, affectionately known as the AHP. And so when Connie talks about how competitive funds are, they actually have to put an application in, and it had to meet certain characteristics in order to get the funding. And one of the things that allowed us to fund this was really the fact that it was focused on veterans, and it had the wraparound and supportive services necessary to service those veterans. And so for us, that scored a lot of points in our program, so we were able to make an award. And in fact, we're putting $500,000 into this project, so we're really proud about that. I did also want to make mention that the Affordable Housing Program at the bank is actually celebrating its 25th anniversary. And the numbers in Massachusetts are pretty impressive. We've actually funded nearly $120 million of subsidies in Massachusetts, both in terms of a direct subsidy, that's just a capital grant, but we also provide what we call these subsidized loans. And those subsidized loans equate to $90 million. So when you look at all of that, we've helped to assist over 15,000 units of affordable housing in Massachusetts. So we're pretty proud at the bank about what the program is doing, and we look forward to the next 25 years. This is actually our first project with the Dartmouth Housing Authority. What I will say is that we are seeing in our program an increasing number of housing authorities getting back into the development game. And I think that's a really positive thing, because they do need to be meeting some of these needs in the communities that they serve. So that's a good thing. This is our sixth project, as I try to get my notes together here. This is actually our sixth project with Bay Coast Bank. So I do want to congratulate Nicholas Chris. I also want to congratulate Carl Tabor, Jim Wallace, and Ann Auger. I mean, they're a great team. Christine Rogers, who works with me, is the direct point person with Bay Coast. But we really work collaboratively together in order to get these projects done. And so congratulations, Carl. I also did want to give some additional acknowledgement to the Women's Institute. Gabby, I'm not going to cry, but Gabby is great. She is great. Just serving as a consultant on this project. And at the end of the day, I'm looking forward to coming back and really seeing this beautiful project and serving those 9 veterans. So thank you and congratulations again.
Thank you so much. I can't help it if I'm a big baby. You know, it is what it is. It's a lot of time coming to this, so. We have a few more funders I'd like to recognize. Mass Housing, through the Center of Community Recovery Innovations, who provided an early grant fund for the project. Ed Chase couldn't make it, but we send him our thanks and gratitude as well. Charles Bank Home Foundation provided early grant funds for the project. And also to Mass Division of Capital Asset Management and Maintenance, Mary Gardell, she was supposed to make it, but she didn't. If Mary hadn't written the first letter and said, "We have a vacant building, do you want it?" we wouldn't be standing here. And I have to thank Mary, because in the beginning, the red tape and the protocol that we had to go to was overburdening. But she stuck with us. She got the wording on the deed. She got everything done the right way for us. And I'm really sorry she's not here so that we could personally thank her. But we do send her our thanks, Mary Gardell. At this time, I would like to introduce the president of our Partners in Housing, Michael Gagne. We formed this nonprofit, and it has been an awesome group of people to work with. I couldn't ask for a more well-rounded group and supportive group. So at this point, Michael.
Good morning. It's an exciting day because I think many of you will remember President Barack Obama signed an executive order, I want to say probably maybe about 3 years ago. And that order was that within a period of time, every U.S. service veteran would in fact have housing. Now, when they made the announcement, the press release on that issue, it sort of struck me in two ways. First of all, it sort of struck me as very, very saddened to learn that not all U.S. service veterans have opportunity to have adequate housing. In the light of the issue of what they have done in the service of their country, I thought that was rather despicable. But then as I looked at the issue, I thought, well, that is something that is achievable, but how do you look at it on the big picture? As the old adage, and you've seen it on a bumper sticker, it says, think globally, act locally. And I'm an ardent supporter of that particular motto because I think things have to happen on a local level. The federal government and everybody else can't do everything for you. It has to happen at the grassroots. Two individuals who were intricate to bringing this project together were dynamic individuals. I'll start with Bill O'Connor. Bill O'Connor was one of the very first members on the Affordable Housing Committee in Dartmouth, and that gentleman religiously, through all the time, through the good times and through his illness and everything, would attend those meetings and work arduously towards the support of housing for veterans in this community. Bill was a great guy, a patient guy, and he had a vision, and that was to address the issue of adequate housing in this community for veterans that have served this country. The other individual, Charles Sisson. If you haven't met Charles Sisson, I feel bad for you. This individual is an individual that was so dynamic in his pursuit of issues of housing for the elderly, services for the elderly, and for veterans, that, you know, it was a tremendous pleasure to work with someone with that kind of enthusiasm. So those two individuals get together, they pair up, their involvement with the Dartmouth Housing Authority, they're able to come together with the support and endorsement of the Housing Authority and its membership to start the grassroots effort to get this rolling. So I'm very excited to be a member along with the other members of Partners in Housing, working with Connie, who's a tremendous asset in pulling together all the aspects of this project. And it's very exciting today that finally units of housing will be created locally for veterans in this community. I see the media here, I see the newspapers here and things. I throw out the challenge to other communities. Get in contact with Connie and with Gabby. I know the community that I represent now is going to move forward with a project on veterans housing. I've got the support of the Board of Selectmen to move forward in that direction. The blueprint is in place. Every community in southeastern Massachusetts, like they do in New Bedford with the Veterans Transition Housing, should be providing affordable, decent, adequate housing for veterans. So I thank you for your support, and I think Connie has done a great job of recognizing all the individuals involved. You see how many of them they are. But this is a great thing, and I'm much excited, and I thank you for coming. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. I'm just going to divert from our schedule here. Rob Smith from JMB Architect has come. Rob, we can't thank you enough. We have such a great working relationship. We go way back, well, not with you so much, but with the firm, we go way back. And when I ran into Joe Booth at my very, very first CPC meeting to ask the CPC for their support, I turned around and Joe Booth was sitting there. And he was the first architect I worked with 24 years ago when I started in housing. And I went, oh my God. So circles do come around, and I am so thrilled that you are the architect of record, and I look forward to working with you over the next few months. We also have a representative here. Actually, we have two representatives here from CDAC. That is the Community Economic Development Assistant Corporation, and they provided us, ready for this number, with $884,806 in housing innovation funds. We could not have done this without CDAC as well. I'd like to introduce Bree Horwitz and Roger Herzog, who will give us a few words. Roger?
Thank you, Connie. Good morning, everyone. I can't imagine a more appropriate place to be on this day than helping to start work on 9 units of permanently supportive housing for our veterans. As you can tell, Connie's gone through the roster of all the people that it takes to put a project like this together. You know, it comes down to people and programs, but it starts with vision. And Mr. Gagne has talked about the 2 individuals who inspired this vision, and our veterans here today are a reminder of how important it is to make sure that we take care of those who have served our country. So with that vision, we move on to programs, and you should be very proud of your state delegation for supporting a state that provides significant capital dollars to build permanent supportive housing developments like this. To do a project successfully, this is not just bricks and mortar. You need good quality housing, but you also need services that will be available to help the people who are going to live there get back on their feet and make progress towards leading a self-sufficient life. So it's both the housing and the services piece that are so critical. A few years ago, the legislature passed an act called the Community Housing and Services Bill that called on the administration to improve the way that Massachusetts creates supportive housing and services. And all of the state agencies that are involved in this, including our agency, CDAC, and the agency that IANA works for, DHCD, and several others, to improve our coordination about how we fund these projects on the capital side, on the operating side, because it takes dollars to run this housing year after year, and on the service side. Those programs also need funding. And I'm pleased to tell you that over the last few years, with that direction from the legislature, Massachusetts has developed over 1,500 units of permanent supportive housing across the state. And Mr. Gagne, I'm pleased to tell you that we have over 500 units of permanent supportive housing for veterans in Massachusetts that's currently under development. And your 9 units here are a very important part of that. So congratulations to you all for doing that. Both the Housing Innovations Fund and the HIPSTIF, long name, programs are from the state, providing $1.5 million of capital to help the O'Connor Sisson House become a reality. I also want to acknowledge how important it is that the town of Dartmouth stepped up with over $500,000 of local funds to support this development. That is the kind of partnership that it takes among funders to create this badly needed housing. I want to congratulate our project manager on this, Bree Horwitz, who worked very closely with Connie and her team on bringing this project to this day. As you can tell, it's a complicated process developing. For the work that's going in, we should be developing hundreds of units, but we're happy to be helping to create 9 units here in Dartmouth. Congratulations to all of our partners, and we look forward to seeing this project progress. Thank you.
Thank you, Roger. It certainly has been a team effort. One of our last speakers is the chair of my board, Elaine Lancaster.
Thank you. I also want to say good morning and welcome, and thank you all for coming. I would like to take the opportunity to recognize the team of people who have worked together through the years to help bring this project to where we are today. The staff of the Dartmouth Housing Authority, with Connie, the executive director. She has given so much time and effort. It's unbelievable. Her staff, I want to mention Shelley, Rosemary, and Carrie, without their help and their support, we couldn't have gone through all the phases that we've gone through. The maintenance men, the support and the men, so much that they have done, Mike, Leo, and Ryan, they have been the helping hand, the maintenance, not only here, but the other sites. Thank you, fellas. The nonprofit, Partners in Housing, and my fellow Dartmouth board members, thank you. Thank you for the many hours that we've spent planning and making all these decisions. This is a project that we are also very, very proud of. Thank you.
Thank you, Ryan. See, I'm not the only one who's sensitive. At this time, I know that, I don't know how exactly we're going to do this, but we're going to go to the front of the building, and we are actually going to break ground. We have shovels and hard hats, and we are going to break ground. That's the most important part of this whole thing, right? Because once the ground is broken, then we can start construction. So we're going to do that. But at this point, before we go to the front of the building, there's a few other people I just want to mention and thank. First of all, you've seen the minibus drive back and forth, and if you don't want to walk back to the parking lot, you can jump on the minibus. Thank you, Dartmouth Council on the Aging. Love having those shuttles. Bay Coast Bank, for sponsoring our luncheon that we're having in a little while. Thank you so much to Paula Freitas, Monica Furtado, who is the branch manager here on State Road, and Milena Mello, the branch manager in Dartmouth, on Dartmouth Street, excuse me. Thank you so much for your generosity and your help. Michael Moniz from DC Cable TV. Where did he go? Oh, it's you. You're like, where'd you go? Okay, it's been a long, long morning. It started at 2 this morning. Thank you so much for coming. Yeah, it did start at 2 this morning. No sleep. That's okay. And Seth Thomas from the Dartmouth Weekly. Seth, thank you so much. He is an awesome, awesome writer. I mean, he did some articles on the quilts. I'm sure if anybody has picked up the Dartmouth Weekly, we had some ladies from the town who made quilts. And I didn't want to bring them today because that'll be part of the ribbon cutting ceremony. But these women made quilts, most of them by hand, so that every veteran will have a quilt on their bed when they come in to take residency. I was overwhelmed by these women. It was amazing. And you did a great job with the article. And I look forward to reading what you're going to write about us. Make sure it's good. To the other members of the newspapers and publicity, we thank you so much for coming out here this morning. It's just been, again, like I said, a project that we've had so much support. The phone rings every once in a while and they'll ask questions. And it's been like, really? Now, how much longer are we going to wait to actually do something here? And I was like, yeah, as long as it takes. But it's here. And again, I thank you for the support in town and the publicity. So I'm not quite sure how we're going to do this. We're going to ask the funders and Mrs. Sisson and Mrs. O'Connor to come out front. You can all come up front, take pictures and whatever. We're going to break ground.